See the sun Love is an ocean, you can drown me. The sweet embrace, the lovely taste, I taste the sea. I'm under grace, the place to be. It means I'll never need an umbrella. I'm cool in the cold, in the hot weather. Whether or never I ever understand, I'm a man in the hands of great plans. I stand with faith and a life I never known to touch. Instead, I saw my clutch, but I'm like, what's the dream of? What's the hope in? What's the doubt for? Live to no end, this is living. The life I've been given's a gift. If I'm a living, I'm a living to death. So what's the dream of? What's the hope in? What's the doubt for? And live to no end, this is living. The life I've been given's a gift. If I'm a living, I'm a living to death. Yeah.
Today is the day you have made. Welcome to Church at Home. Wherever you may be, wherever you're tuning in from, you are most welcome. We're delighted you're able to join with us as we gather to sit around God's word and to worship our risen Lord and Saviour.
So our Bible reading today is from Genesis chapter 45. So if you've got a Bible to hand, you might want to grab that. And later in today's service, we're going to be hearing from our girls group, which is part of our youth group. So that should be really fun too.
And so we're going to head into a time of worship. But before we do, let's just pray to open our service together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a good God. We ask that you would send that good gift of your Holy Spirit into our hearts and into our homes. And help us to lift our eyes to you, our strength and our song. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Saints, let's worship together. With girls group, well, some of the girls group, some of the young people themselves and their leaders.
And I thought it'd be great to have a catch up this morning about what's been happening with our girls group. Girls group, for those who don't know, is like one of our connect groups, one of our small groups, but they meet midweek, and it's for girls only, teenage girls only, and they've been doing some great stuff. And like all of our connect groups, they've got three different important dimensions. One of them is an inward dimension where they, you know, really get to know each other well and love one another and journey with one another. And then there's an upward dimension where they focus on God. But also with all of our groups, we try to have an outward dimension. You know, we try to love our neighbour and bless our neighbours. So I thought this morning, let's catch up with our girls group and hear a little bit about what they've been up to. So, Kathy, do you want to start us off? What you've been doing in girls group?
Yeah, okay. And we've just been doing some Bible studies with some information that was sent to us by Open Doors to look at what other Christians in other countries and in other situations around the world are facing, and in amongst their difficult situations, how God is really helping them and speaking to them. And through the things that we were looking at, we've been looking at what their lives are like and some of the things that they face. And we wondered whether perhaps we could do something that could help in their difficult situations, whether there's anything we could do to help. So we've got some fantastic girls with loads of brilliant ideas. But we've just brought a couple of them here with us today to tell you what they were thinking about doing. So we did offer them a challenge. If we were to give them £10, could they raise any more money with that £10 to support a charity called the Tanzania UK Trust, which is in Dodoma in Tanzania, and it's a health centre that I've been supporting over a number of years, but are currently going through the COVID crisis like the rest of us. They've also got a few other issues with flooding and locusts, and it's a really difficult time. And we wondered if, with all of that that's going on, we could raise some money to help them support people whilst COVID is hitting and whilst lots of people are unable to sort of earn a living and make money for themselves. So, £10 challenge.
Wow, so you're getting £10 seed money, and it sounds like a great cause that you're raising money for. So let's head over first of all to Leah. You're joined with your mum Sarah, aren't you? And Sarah also helps run Girls Group with Kathy. So Leah, do you want to tell us a little bit about how you used your £10 seed money?
Yeah, so what we did is we did a waffle sale, and it was outside of, it was in the, like,
In the front garden. Yeah.
And lots of people down our road came, and it was very good. And we had markers for 2 feet away with chalk on the floor.
What, 2 meters. 2 meters.
Oh, yeah, social distancing happening. Well done.
Yeah, so Leah got a chalk out and she put lines on the pavement beforehand so people were 2 meters apart, and we put a message on the street WhatsApp. Yeah. And we had lots and lots of people come and buy our waffles at a social distance.
Cool. Yeah,
and then in the end we ended up making £10 into £315, which is very good.
Well done, that's amazing, that is. So that is absolutely fantastic. Well done, Leah. So that sounds amazing. Did you manage to have any waffles yourself?
Yeah, we had me, my brother and my mum were doing it, and then we also brought up some to my dad when he was working.
Well done. Have you got any idea about how many waffles you sold altogether?
Probably about 60 or 80 or something. There's a lot.
Wow.
So chocolate and cream or lemon or sugar, lots of different options.
So normally we'd have a pancake party around the vicarage, but maybe next year we need to have a waffle party around Hudson's house. Yeah. Sounds great. Well done, Leah. Really big well done for doing that. That's raised a tremendous amount of money. That's fantastic. Alice, do you want to say a little bit about what you've got planned?
Well, for what I'm doing, I'm having a concert and I'm live streaming it on YouTube tonight at 5:30.
Fantastic. So 5:30 tonight, and we can all tune in for that. And you've also got a Just Giving page, is that right?
Yeah.
That's fantastic. So for those who want to come along and support you, they can log on at 5:30 tonight and hear your concert. Do you want to say what you're going to be doing as part of that concert?
Well, I play the harp and the piano, so I'll be playing 12 pieces, half on my harp and half on my piano.
Fantastic, fantastic. Do you want to tell people how old you are?
I'm 14.
You're 14 years old. You're playing the harp and piano. That's very impressive. So, and I hear that you're quite good. So your recent exams have just been cancelled because of COVID. But what exams were you meant to be taking this summer?
I was meant to be taking grade 6 on the harp and grade 8 on piano.
Oh, wonderful. Well, a big congratulations. So we're looking forward to a musical extravaganza later. So for anybody who's interested in joining us for that concert that's being streamed live at 5:30 tonight, we will send out details. Actually, we'll send out details to anyone who's on our mailing list so that they can either join you for the concert or give through your Just Giving page. So that's wonderful to hear that that's happening, and we're looking forward to having that later. We can see your harp in the background behind you there. So well, that's really great to hear. We know that there's other members of the girls group that's going to be doing some great stuff, and we hope in the coming weeks to hear a little bit about what they've been up to. But I just wanted to say thank you so much for sharing what you've been up to in girls group. It's really encouraging for us all to hear. God bless you. Well done, and we're going to head into a time of worship together now.
In the darkness, you were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the world, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings.
To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise.
Shall not kneel, shall not faint. by his blood and in his name. In his freedom I am free, for the love of Jesus Christ who has resurrected me. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. As we think of the cross and of Jesus' sacrifice, let's humbly and joyfully turn to prayer, guided this morning by Jesus' example and teachings. Jesus' death at the hands of sinful men has allowed us to know God. We pray for the aftermath following the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis. We thank you for the Floyd family's call for peace and the worldwide calls for justice and equality. We pray that good would come from this deeply disturbing death and the resulting protests. Amen. Jesus likened his kingdom to an abundant harvest. We thank you for the many schemes put in place to protect people economically during the COVID crisis. We pray for those who are feeling anxious about their employment situation, those who have lost their jobs, key workers whose work has put their health and that of their families at increased risk. Lord of the harvest, give us hope, give us protection, give us what we need. Amen. Jesus likened his kingdom to a pearl of great price that one would sell everything to possess. Father, we thank you for human creativity and scientific understanding. We pray for the development of effective coronavirus treatments and vaccines that have become so important to humanity. We pray that these may come quickly and will be distributed fairly globally. Amen. Jesus likened his kingdom to a wedding, a time to celebrate with family and friends. We thank you for our friends and family. When celebration opportunities are limited, we pray for those who are feeling isolated from those that they love, those that are grieving for loved ones, or are concerned for those who are ill or are ongoing treatment. Provide comfort and hope in the name of Jesus. Amen. Before David speaks to us this morning, we'll continue with Joseph's story from Genesis 45. Joseph has had his brothers brought back to him after they've been to Egypt to buy grain. And we have this touching moment when he reveals himself to them. So Genesis 45. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Make everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they had done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed. Do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been a famine in the land. And for the next 5 years, there will be ploughing. There will not be ploughing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So then, it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household and ruler of Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and say to him, 'This is what your son Joseph says. God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, don't delay. You shall live in the region of Goshen and be near me. You,
your children and grandchildren, your flocks and herds and all you have. I will provide for you there, because 5 years of famine are still to come. Otherwise you and your household and all who belong to you will become destitute. You can see for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, that it really is I who am speaking to you. Tell my father all about the honour accorded to me in Egypt, and about everything you have seen, and bring my father down here quickly. Then he threw his arms around his brother Benjamin and wept, and Benjamin embraced him weeping, and he kissed all his brothers and wept over them, and afterwards his brothers talked with him. When the news reached Pharaoh's palace that Joseph's brothers had come, Pharaoh and all his officials were pleased. Joseph said to Pharaoh, "Tell your brothers, do this, load your animals and return to the land of Canaan, and bring your father and your families back to me. I will give you the best of the land of Egypt, and you can enjoy the fat of the land." You are also directed to tell them, "Do this, take some carts from Egypt for your children and your wives, and get your father and come. Never mind about your belongings, because the best of all Egypt will be yours." So the sons of Israel did this. Joseph gave them carts, as Pharaoh had commanded, and he also gave them provisions for their journey.
Well, thank you, Ian, for leading us in that time of prayer and also for bringing us our Bible reading. What a great and rich Bible passage that was. There's so many things we could pick up on from that passage. But to help us to focus, I'm going to just concentrate on one verse today, and that verse is verse 7. Joseph says these words, "God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance." Well, to help unpack what this verse might mean for us today, we've got five S's to consider: source, seek, steward, shape, and share. There's a good tongue twister to get us going. So it was right about 10 years ago to this month, 10 years ago, that there was an unknown app on the market. That app was called Burnt, and it was quite clunky and complicated. So what the developers decided to do was to strip it down, and they focused on just one thing. The thing that they focused on was photos, and they relaunched this app, and they gave the app a new name as they relaunched it. And the name that they gave it was Instagram. Instagram was an overnight success. Today, it is the fastest growing social media platform. Well, if Burnt needed to be stripped back before becoming an overnight success, we can also see that this is true in the life of Joseph. When we first meet Joseph back in chapter 37, Joseph is a spoiled, insensitive 17-year-old. And over the next 13 years, God was stripping him back, preparing him, and so that he would be ready to be relaunched. So overnight, Joseph went from becoming a prisoner to a prime minister. What a step that is to take overnight. He became God's man, in God's place, in God's time. In those 13 years of preparation, Joseph passed many tests of temptation, tests of waiting for God's vindication. But now he faced the challenge of prosperity. You see, handling success is sometimes harder than handling failure. And yet, Joseph passed the prosperity test with flying colours. And he's a great example to us about how God can raise people up and give them remarkable influence. So, many centuries on, what lessons can we learn today from the life of Joseph? Well, our first S is source. We need to acknowledge God as the source of our many blessings. In our passage today, in our verse today, Joseph acknowledges it is God who is the source of his blessings. He says, "God sent me ahead of you." Overnight, he became incredibly rich and powerful. In our all-age service a couple of weeks ago for our Bible reading, because it was all-age, we got some of the children from our church to draw pictures to help narrate the Bible reading. And all the pictures were great. The picture that I was drawn to was this very simple stick man. And the reason why I loved it is because even if you look closely at the stick man of Joseph, you could see a tiny little ring on his finger and also a necklace around his neck. Now, both the ring and the necklace was mentioned in the passage for that week. And the reason why they're mentioned is because the ring is a symbol of the power that was entrusted to Joseph. And the necklace was a symbol of great wealth. God had prepared Joseph through the years, and now he entrusted Joseph with great wealth and with great power. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong with power and wealth. It's how we yield these things that means that they will become of great good or they result in great harm. So we need to yield and exercise power and wealth incredibly sensitively. How would Joseph use his power and wealth? Would he use it for self-seeking purposes, for great harm, or would he use it for the interest of others, for great good? Well, we can see that he certainly used his power and influence for great good. He organized a feeding program to save Egypt and the surrounding nations. Well, Joseph is an example to us, isn't he, of how to harness power and wealth well. How will we use the gifts that God has given us? Do we use them to advance our own kingdom, to build our own kingdoms, to serve our own agendas? Or will we use the influence and the power and the money that God has given us to advance God's kingdom and his agenda? So the first S is source. We need to acknowledge that God is the source of our many blessings, and to look to use the things that he has given us, that he has entrusted to us for a certain period of time, that we might build his kingdom. So source. Second S, seek. Again, there's nothing particularly wrong with money, power, or possessions, but the Bible and Jesus in particular has a lot to say about our attitude to money, possessions, and power. We read throughout the Bible that these should never be the focus of our thoughts. The love of these things actually leads to destruction. We are warned time and again not to seek these things. Let's read a passage from the New Testament, from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 9 to 11. Stark warning: people who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. How sad it is that they pierce themselves with many griefs. Instead of striving for money, power, and possessions, we should instead be contented with the gifts that God has given us. Actually, it's mentioned this in the couple of verses preceding. It says this: for godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Saints, if you've got food in your cupboards, if you've got clothing in your backs, let us be contented. It's a way to blessing. So we are not to seek money and power. So what is it that we should seek? Well, Jesus is clear about this in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 6. Straight after a teaching about our attitude to money and possessions, Jesus utters these famous words. He says this: seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. We are to seek first God's kingdom. Like Joseph, he sought God's kingdom. I wonder what you want out of this period of lockdown? I wonder if you spent any time reflecting about, you know, after we've emerged from this season, what do you want from this season? Maybe it's a change to the pace of life. The pace of life can just be, seem so frantic at times, doesn't it? Perhaps we want to slow things down a little bit. Perhaps we want to refocus on some of the important relationships in our lives, friendships, family. Well, surely we must also take Jesus' words to heart. These things are all great and noble things, but Jesus tells us to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things, all these good things, will be given to you as well. So let's seek first God's kingdom and his righteousness. What a tragedy it would be if we emerge from this season of lockdown and having not invested in our relationship with Jesus. It would be a crying shame. God is wanting the church to emerge from this season stronger than ever. And to do this, we are called to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. So, source, seek, third, steward. We are called to steward well. Each of us, each and every one of us, has been given time, skills, and monies, what some people call time, talents, and treasures. And God expects us to steward these well. This week, I've been reflecting personally over Jesus' parable of the 10 miners, taken from Luke chapter 19. I find this parable really challenging. It speaks of a man who heads off on a long journey, and he's going to be crowned king. And before he heads off, he gathers his servants together and gives them each a miner. And we hear about how three of these servants get on. The first servant puts this miner, a miner is an amount of money, basically worth about 3 months' wages. The first servant puts his miner to good work, he stewards it well, and he earns 10 more. When his master returns, he's really pleased with his servant, and as a reward, he places him in charge of 10 cities. The next servant we hear of puts the miner to good use. Again, he stewards his gift well, and he earns 5 more miners. And his reward is that he is put in charge of 5 cities. And lastly, we hear about the third servant. Now, this servant basically did nothing with his miner. He laid it, he didn't steward it well, he just laid it to one side, let his gift go dormant. He wrapped it in a piece of cloth. And when his master returns, he is deeply upset with this servant. And he basically takes the gift of miner off him and gives it to someone else. Through this parable, Jesus is teaching us that we are supposed to use not only our money, but all of our gifts for the benefit of the king and his kingdom. We are supposed to steward wisely, to use wisely our money, our time, our education, the jobs that we have, the skills that we have, the opportunities that God has given us for his kingdom. And Joseph is a great example of someone who stewarded his gifts really well, didn't he? He initiated, he organized and implemented a nationwide saving scheme over the 7 years of abundance, so he was able to feed Israel and the nation of Egypt over the 7 years of famine. He certainly stewarded his gifts well. He was a practical, hands-on leader. He traveled around the nations. He didn't sit on his laurels. He worked well. He stewarded his gifts well. Likewise, like Joseph stewarded his gifts well, we are called to steward our gifts well. Take some time to think about the time that God has given you, perhaps in this season of lockdown or in another season. Are you stewarding your time well? How are you putting your money to use? Are you using it to advance his kingdom? How are the skills that God has given you? Are you using them to advance God's kingdom? Are you trying to advance God's kingdom in the jobs that you have? Are you using every opportunity for God's kingdom? Steward well the gifts that God has given you. So that's source, seek, steward, and fourthly, shape. Our vision here across our churches is simple. It's love, share, transform. We're called to love Jesus, we're called to share lives, and we're called to transform communities. And that third one is really what it's picking up on. We're called to transform communities, we're called to shape communities. We are called to transform our towns, our cities, our nation, our society. You know, this week I attended a leadership seminar with the former Bishop of Bristol. His name is Mike Hill, and he's part of the Global Leadership Network, and he's the CEO for the Global Leadership Network here in the UK. And the conversation that was being had was around leading in a shifting culture. And he talked about the call upon all Christians to influence society, to shape culture rather than to be shaped by it. And yes, this will take courage, but it is the call of the church to transform society, to transform communities. Again, Jesus speaks about this in another one of his parables in Luke's Gospel, the parable of the yeast. Jesus says these famous words, "What shall I compare the kingdom of God to? It is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into a large amount of flour until it worked all through the dough." Our vision needs to be big, doesn't it? This yeast, the kingdom of God is meant to work all through the dough. We are the yeast. We are meant to transform, to shape, to influence society and culture. We need to raise up people to be the next generation of politicians and leaders in all spheres of society, in media, in finance, in commerce. You know, we want to shape society. The church is not meant to be shaped by culture. We are meant to shape culture. Each year, the Collins English Dictionary releases a word of the year. For 2019, that word was climate strike. But one word that narrowly missed out on the top spot last year was the word influencer. Saints, as Christians, as followers of Jesus, we are called to be influencers. We are called to transform our communities and to shape culture. We are called to be a voice for those who don't have a voice for justice. We've got media tension at present, don't we, with issues of racial injustice sparked by the tragic death of George Floyd in the US. And the church is called to speak up on issues of justice, to speak out against injustice wherever we find it. We are called to shape society. Joseph was a man who was immersed in a foreign culture, the Egyptian culture, with their different gods and their different value systems. But he wasn't shaped by the culture of the day. Rather, he stayed faithful to God. He named his children Manasseh and Ephraim, two Hebrew names. Source, seek, steward, shape, and our last S is share. So, Joseph spent 13 years in preparation, and then he stepped into a season of blessing. For the last 9 years, he'd been ruling as prime minister of the whole nation, and he was second only to Pharaoh himself. It was a position of great influence and of great affluence. Joseph had been blessed, and what a common strand we find through scripture is this: people are blessed to be a blessing to others. We are blessed to be a blessing. When Joseph first had his dream, he assumed it was all about him, that God wanted to raise him up to a position of influence and affluence for his own sake and for his own comfort. However, 22 years on now from chapter that we first heard the dream, this young dreamer has matured greatly. He realizes that the dream isn't about him. He realizes that he has been blessed to be a blessing. Let's read again verse 7. "But God sent me ahead of you. Why? To preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance." See how this dreamer has matured. You know, the dream is being fulfilled. God is the insensitive, arrogant young man, only interested in his own self-elevation. Joseph now draws our attention from himself and places it upon God and God's good purposes being fulfilled. the salvation of the nations. So, what does this mean for us today? Well, likewise, we are blessed to be a blessing. We are to share. One of our values here at St. Peter's, part of our DNA, is generosity. You know, generosity is a mark of God. And likewise, it's meant to be a mark of us, his children. We're not meant to store up God's blessings for ourselves. We're meant to give them away generously. Joseph, in our passage today, is pictured as the saviour of the then known world. We read that he saved lives by a great deliverance. Well, if that was a great deliverance, Joseph is only pointing to Jesus, the great deliverer, the saviour of the entire world. Joseph brought a limited salvation for a limited period of time, providing bread for the people, whereas Jesus calls himself the bread of life, and he brings full salvation. Physical bread satisfies for a moment, but only Jesus can satisfy the deepest needs of humanity. Only Jesus, the bread of life, can do this. We are blessed to be a blessing. And so there are two ways in which we can be a blessing. First, we can share the good news of Jesus with our friends, our families, and our neighbours. We are to share Jesus, the bread of life, with others, the only one who can truly satisfy our deepest needs. You know, people really need to hear the good news of Jesus and the joy and the life and the forgiveness and the freedom that is found in him. So we're to share the good news of Jesus. And secondly, we are to share our lives in a way that responds to the real physical needs of the world. Our passage today shows us that God is not only interested in our spiritual needs, he's also deeply interested in our physical needs. God sent Joseph ahead of his brothers to provide for the real economic, social, and physical needs of the people. And like Joseph, we are called to respond to the practical needs of people. Now, this might be raising funds for a health centre thousands of miles away, like the Girls Group have been doing for a health centre in Tanzania, or it could be picking up a prescription for our next door neighbour. There are a huge number of ways in which we can respond to the practical needs of the world. So that's our five S's, our five lessons from the life of Joseph this morning. Source, seek, steward, shape, and share. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the source of all of our blessings. Help us to seek first your kingdom. Give us wisdom to steward well the gifts that you have given us. Help us to shape society and culture, that we may be lights and salt to the world. And help us to share the good news of Jesus with all, not only with our words, but also with our actions. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're now going to head into a time of worship together. And as Joseph points us to Jesus, the great saviour, so we're now going to fix our eyes on Jesus and his saving work upon the cross. Let's worship.
When I survey the Prince of Glory died, my riches gain I count as loss, and poor contempt on all my pride. Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, sacrifice them to his blood. See, from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow in the whole town. Did Esther's love
to the end of our service now. Thank you so much for joining us. It was really great to have you with us.
This Tuesday is our Encounter prayer meeting. It runs from 7:30 till 8:30, and we would love to have you join with us for that. This month we're going to be focusing on issues of social justice, picking up on some of the things that have been happening in America, and we're also going to be joined by one of our mission partners, Recharge. This mission partner does great work in and around our local area, working with children and families. If you'd like to join with us, then an email containing instructions of how to join that prayer meeting will be sent out over the next couple of days. Do keep your eye out for that. And if you're not on our mailing list, then please just contact the church office and we'd love to send you out the link and welcome you into our prayer meeting.
Also this evening, we've got Alice's concert at 5:30. Please do tune in. It'd be really great to support her in that. And remember that you can give via their Just Giving page.
And so this Sunday we've been looking about how Joseph was a blessing, was blessed so that he could be a blessing to others. And so let us close with that Old Testament blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Saints, thank you for joining with us. God bless, and I'll see you soon.
The Lord bless you.